We are the Gujarat Technological University. Since its inception over a decade ago, GTU has been empowering young and curating minds to realize their true potential. Over 4 lakh inspired students are enrolled with one of the premier academic universities in India. With more than 450 affiliated colleges in its fold operating across 5 zones of the state, GTU, the International Innovative University, your place to move forward.
A very good morning, good afternoon, good night, whenever you will watch this video. So today our topic is second law of thermodynamics. So over here I have written second law of thermodynamics. Now to understand second law, first of all we should know that second law has been given by two different scientists. First scientist was Calvin Planck. So first scientist was Calvin Planck, and he has given one statement for the first law, and then next scientist was Clausius, and Clausius has given one statement. And if you will combine both of these statements, so that both of these statements are known as second law of thermodynamics. Now, first of all, we will understand about this statement which has been given by Calvin Planck. So Calvin Planck has done what? He has taken the heat engine. I will write HE. HE represents what? Heat engine. And Clausius has taken one heat pump. HP means heat pump. So first is Calvin Planck's statement. That statement we will try to understand. That first of all I will take one heat engine. So over here one heat engine HE is present. Now that heat engine is present in between two reservoirs. Now reservoirs means what? That reservoirs has two types. First type is known as source. So over here I will write source. And source temperature is T1. And second type of reservoir is shrink. So I will write shrink. Its temperature is T2. Now source means what? That it is such a reservoir from which your heat engine will absorb the heat energy. So I will draw an arrow like this, indicating heat Q1 from T1 temperature of source, heat engine will absorb Q1 amount of heat energy. And shrink means what? That it is such a reservoir to which heat engine will reject the heat energy. So heat engine will reject how much amount of energy? Q2 amount of energy to the shrink which is present at T2 temperature. And then it will produce the work. So that is the diagram to understand the Calvin Planck statement. So Calvin Planck statement is what? That if a heat engine wants to do some work, at that time heat engine has to exchange its heat energy, which is Q1 and Q2, with two reservoirs which are present at different temperatures T1 and T2. Then only heat engine is capable to produce some work. Achha, one more time I will say, if a heat engine wants to produce some work, as for example, one student is there whose name is suppose Ramesh. If Ramesh wants to score in exam, then what Ramesh has to do? Ramesh has to read hard. Then only Ramesh can score in exam. Similar way, if a heat engine wants to produce some work, at that time heat engine has to do what? It has to exchange its heat energy, which is Q1 and Q2, with two reservoirs which are present at T1, different temperatures T1 and T2. But supposing if somebody will say that heat engine is producing some work by exchanging its heat energy with a single reservoir, then work done is possible? No, work done is not possible. At that time you will say Q2 equals to 0, and if Q2 equals to 0, that means your heat engine is exchanging its heat energy with a single reservoir, and then work is produced, which is impossible, which is also known as perpetual motion machine of first kind. And perpetual motion, that is also known as PMMF 1, in which what's happened? Q2 equals to 0. That is the condition for perpetual motion machine of first kind, in which your heat engine is producing some work. How? By exchanging its heat energy with a single reservoir, and which is not possible. And that is why perpetual motion machine of first is also not possible. Achha, so when heat engine will produce some work by exchanging its heat energy with both of the reservoirs, then that type of machine is known as PMM2. So that is known as perpetual motion machine of second kind. And in that machine, heat engine is producing some work by exchanging its heat energy with two different reservoirs, and that type of thing is possible. So PMM2 is also possible, and PMM2 will support the Kelvin-Planck statement. And over here, what I have written, it is impossible to construct a device. So supposing your heat engine is what? It is a device. Which type of device is impossible to construct? Which is exchanging its heat energy with a single reservoir. So such device is there, which is exchanging its heat energy with a single reservoir. And then what that engine is doing and producing some work. That means it is impossible to construct a device which is doing what? Which is exchanging its heat energy with a single reservoir and which is producing some work. That means if you want to produce the work with the help of heat engine, at that time how many reservoirs are required? Two reservoirs are required. Then only work can be produced, and then only this type of machine is known as perpetual motion machine of second kind. And if heat engine is producing some work with the help of a single reservoir, so which is not possible, and that is known as PMM1, in which heat engine is producing some work by exchanging its heat energy with a single reservoir. Now we have talked about PMM1, PMM2, we will complete also PMM3 as we are discussing about the series of PMM1, 2 and 3. PMM3 means what? First of all, that PMM3 is also not possible. PMM3 means what? A rotating device will keep continue its rotation up to the infinite distance under the absence of any frictional force. That is, a rotating device is there which will keep continuous rotation up to which distance? Up to infinite distance, and under which condition? That no friction forces are acting on this body. Now, as you know that any body, friction force is present. That is why, as friction force is present, so that no body can travel up to infinite distance. That is why PMM3 is also not possible. Achha, we are talking about Kelvin-Planck statement. Clear about Kelvin-Planck statement, that it is impossible to construct such a device which is produced some work by exchanging its heat energy with a single reservoir. So for work production, requirement is what? Both of the reservoir must be present, and your heat engine must exchange the heat energy with both of the reservoir. Now, heat engine means what? That it is such a device which will convert the chemical energy of the fuel into a heat energy, and finally that heat energy is converted into a mechanical work. Now, in our bike is also a heat engine. Why? Because in our bike we are using fuel. Fuel has some chemical energy. So chemical energy of the fuel is converted in heat energy. How? That when fuel will burn, so it will produce the heat. So chemical energy is converted into a heat energy, and due to the heat production, our vehicle will work. So that heat energy is converted into a mechanical work. Now, that is all about the discussion about Kelvin-Planck statement. Now, we'll proceed with the Clausius statement. Now, Clausius statement has taken one heat pump. Now, heat pump means what? Over here, I will draw one heat pump. Heat pump means what? That it is such a device which will maintain the temperature higher than or lower than the surrounding temperature. It is such a device which will maintain higher or lower temperature compared to surrounding temperature. That is the meaning of heat pump. As for example, if you will consider heater, so heater means what? It is one type of heat pump which will do what? It will maintain the higher temperature as compared to surrounding temperature. If you will consider refrigerator, so refrigerator is nothing but one type of heat pump. What it will do? Refrigerator will maintain lower temperature of a system as compared to the surrounding temperature. Achha. Now, that heat pump is located in between two reservoirs. So over here, I will draw two reservoirs. First reservoir is known as usual, that is known as shrink, a source having T1 temperature, and over here, shrink, which is at T2 temperature. Now statement is what? That heat can flow, over here I wrote, heat can flow from lower temperature to higher temperature, because source always having a high temperature. Sun means what? Sun is a source of energy. So sun has always the higher energy. So over here one condition you can write like that, in both of the cases T1 is greater than T2. Over here also I will write T1 is greater than T2. So generally law of thermodynamics says what? Heat will always flow from higher temperature to lower temperature. That means heat is flowing from T1 temperature, which is higher, to the lower temperature T2. But the reverse statement is what? Heat can flow from lower temperature to higher temperature. So I will draw the direction of arrow like this: lower temperature Q2 and higher temperature Q1. It is possible, but for that requirement is what? Some external work is required. That means to the heat pump, some work you have to provide, then only heat can flow from lower temperature to higher temperature. Then only it is possible that heat can flow from lower temperature to higher temperature. Otherwise, if over here you will not supply any work, that means work done is zero. Supposing if I will say work done is zero, if I will say, so what's happened? Heat will always flow from higher temperature to lower temperature. But if you will supply some work, so heat will flow from lower temperature to higher temperature. Example for this heat pump, if I want to say, so I can consider refrigerator. Because in refrigerator, what's happened? Low temperature is maintained. How in refrigerator low temperature is maintained? Because to the refrigerator, some work is required in form of electricity. When you supply some work to the refrigerator, so refrigerator will do what? Whatever low temperature is there, that low temperature it will maintain. How it will maintain the low temperature? By rejecting the heat. That means heat is flowing from lower temperature to higher temperature. Inside of the fridge, low temperature is there. In the surrounding, high temperature is there. So heat is rejecting from fridge to surrounding. That means heat is moving from lower temperature to higher temperature by applying some external work. That is the Clausius statement. So clear about that Clausius statement also. Now if you will combine both of the statement, so now that both of the statement is known as second law of thermodynamics. Now over here, when in my previous video I have talked about that some corrections are there in first law. First law, what I told you, as you know that Q is equals to W. That is for a single process. And for that is for a single point. And if more than one point is there, so what you are writing? You are writing dQ is equals to dW. Okay. Now that law modified later, how? That supposing in this diagram, if you will consider in this diagram, if you will consider that W work done, over here I will write work done is equals to how much? Suppose work done is 10 unit. Now heat will be how much? Heat will be also 10 unit. So forget about this. First of all, we consider about heat. Heat is what? Over here Q1 plus Q2 is heat. Q is equals to what? Q1 plus Q2. So Q is equals to what? Q1 is higher than Q2 because T1 is greater than T2. Supposing Q1 is 7 and Q2 is 3. Then only Q will say Q is equals to 10 units. In front of that, work done should be how much? Work done should be also 10 unit. But over here actually what's happened? Q1 amount of the heat is converted in work. And remaining heat is rejected. That rejected heat is not converted in work. So how many amount of heat is converted in work? Q1 amount of heat is converted in work. So Q1 amount of heat is how much? It is 7. So over here if I want to write over here that Q is equals to W, but actual Q is how much? 10 is there. Actual Q is equals to what? Q1 plus Q2, 10. So in front of that W is how much? In front of that W is not 10, but W is how much? W is how much? W is Q1, because Q1 amount of the heat is converted in work done. So that Q1 is how much? Q1 is 7. So work done is what? 7. So 10 equals to 7. Is it correct? No, it is not correct. So to correct this law, we are adding 3 unit more, so that 7 plus 3 equals to 10, and over here also 10, and that 3 unit is known as U. U means what? It is known as internal energy. So actually law is what? Law is not Q equals to W, but Q equals to U plus W. That is the law. So first law is what? Actually first law you will write like this, that is your Q is equals to U plus W. That is for a single point. For more than one point I will write dQ is equal equals to du plus dw. So that law you have to remember. Equation of this is very much important for the derivation of PV raised to gamma equals to C. At that time, directly this equation I will take, and I am not going to explain this, that from where did this equation come. So clear about this equation, that the first law is what, actually dq is equals to du plus dw for more than one point. For single point, q is equals to u plus w. So I hope you understand about each and every point which is present in second law. Now I am going to end my videos. Thank you very much. Read hard, work hard.